Good questions, September 13, 2019 by Anna von Reitz. As a result of three recent articles, The Unknown Past and The Unknown Past, Part 2 and Quick Primer, I have received some good questions that deserve good answers. 1. Is the Civil War ongoing? Do you mean it never ended? The hot war ended in June of 1865 in the Arctic. The last shot was fired by the legendary C.S.S. Shenandoah, one of the finest American fighting vessels of all time. Even this was lied about in our history books, and we were left to believe that the Civil War ended with the surrender of Lee's army at Appomattox, Virginia in April of 1865. Oh, well, those of you who care to know the truth are invited to read Lynn Schooler's The Last Shot. Naval history buffs won't be disappointed. The Cold War has continued, because it has allowed the associated European powers, the British monarch and the Pope, to plug a siphon into our wallets and keep pumping. That this is the fact can be easily observed by the existence of such offices as the United States Attorney General, the Lieutenant Governors, and other undefined quasi-military offices that have no legitimate provenance in our government. Yes, people, those of you who are just waking up. Our disloyal employees have been staging a mercenary Cold War conflict on our shores for 150 years, and they have been conscripting you into this illegal perpetual mercenary war without your knowledge or consent. They have falsified the public records concerning your political status, nationality, and other facts, so as to continue and promote this circumstance, while leaving you no means to object. You can't object or defend yourself, because you have been left ignorant and uninformed, deliberately. Most Americans don't have a clue. The fundamental breach of trust takes place when we are only a few days or weeks old, long before we are truly conscious and able to defend ourselves. This results in unconscionable contracts being set in motion. Keeping us ignorant about the actual circumstance has been their means of enforcing unconscionable contracts benefiting them. They keep the fake war going so that they can continue to claim costs related to the war and so that they can assert oppressive military common law. Instead of supporting and obeying the actual civilian government as their contract demands, they have been running roughshod over their employers. The only courts left that are competent to convene a three-man officer court and make a determination in our favor as a military tribunal are the circuit courts. All the other courts are being operated as private bill collection agencies under a series of deliberate false legal presumptions. They've been treating us like cattle in a stockyard, and picking us off one by one via illegal confiscations and foreclosures, illegally conscripting and press ganging our children, distorting our textbooks, infiltrating our universities, converting our rights into privileges, asserting legislative statutes over the public law, converting our private property into public trusts which their attorneys are allowed to pillage at will. This secretive and highly illegal and immoral plundering has been taking place for decades. 2. How would a declaration of peace change anything? Every time we visited the Civil War in any history class one ever attended, the teacher took it shot at Andrew Johnson, the vice president who became president after Abraham Lincoln's death. We were given no details but left with the impression that Andrew Johnson was a bad president, incompetent, etc. Nothing could be further from the truth. Andrew Johnson is quite possibly the bravest man who ever sat in the president's chair. He issued no less than three public declarations firmly establishing the public peace. He did everything he could to prevent and put an end to exactly the situation described above. The plotters eventually got around his actions by creating corporations to do the dirty work and by getting later presidents to go along with their criminality. Trump, like Johnson, is in a position to put an end to the worst of it by issuing a similar public declaration of peace. He could also open up the electoral process simply by recognizing the over 150 million disenfranchised electors who have been coerced to either 1. Register to vote and give up their property rights to the federal corporations or 2. Stop casting ballots in the general elections and be counted as criminals if they do. This racketeering scheme and manipulation of our electoral process has somewhat backfired on them in that it keeps them from ever achieving a mandate for their democracy, a form of government that is patently alien to our country and our people. 3. What are we going to do about it? At the end of the day, we have to wake up and get organized and stand on the jurisdictions that we are heir to. Now that we know what has gone on here and how we have been misidentified and who and what is being manipulated to secure these deplorable results, we are enabled to take action in our own behalf. First, we have to stop drifting along letting our employees define us and our political status to suit themselves. Because the two sides of this phony war are both groups of our employees, one British group, one Papist group, they have sought to misidentify us as federal employees, too. They do this to involve us in their war and provide themselves with excuses to confiscate our property and harass us. This requires them to mischaracterize us as either a United States citizen, one of the Brits, or as a citizen of the United States, one of the Papists. We are in fact state citizens of a different United States, the United States, with a capital T. Most of us are not federal military employees or dependents, nor are we federal civil service employees or dependents. As a result, the correct way to describe our political status is state citizen of the United States, but the similarity of the names and general ignorance has allowed them to confuse people about which United States is being referenced. They deliberately and forcefully falsify our records at hospitals using the dead baby scam. We are in fact American state nationals at birth and need to reclaim that status. Our team has pioneered a paperwork process to do this. It is explained and templates are made available on my website, www.anavonrights.com, Article 928, and at www.theamericanstatesassembly.net website. A man has no name for himself. God did not give us names and we were not given any authority to name ourselves. All this goes back to biblical constructs in the Western world. So, all living people are nameless. What happens is that we are given a name as a gift and as an inheritance in the same way that we might be given a bicycle. This is your person, also known as your trade name, because you use it to identify yourself and others use it to identify you when conducting business affairs. This given name in the West is bicameral, represented by the House of Lords and the House of Commons in England. Your bicameral name is split in two parts, your Christian name, for example, Peter, and your family or surname, for example, Olson. Peter is supposed to be represented in the House of Lords, while Olson, which is a name that can equally belong to many people, is supposed to be represented in the House of Commons. This same principle applies to the representation in the United States Senate versus the United States House of Representatives. The idea is that we are individually sovereign and lords as living people in our private lives, while maintaining an association with our families and communities in common, thus, there is a natural separation between private interest and public interest which is reflected in the legislative bodies and in our bicameral names. The introduction of a so-called middle name was adopted as a means of creating an additional immaterial person, a business entity separated from this system of recognizable and lawful government. As you will discover if you read law dictionaries, the use of a middle name invalidates this system of lawful national government and puts you in a different international status. Your lawful person is Peter Olson. Your legal person is Peter John Olson. Unfortunately, the legal person has been substituted for the lawful person and as a result, only those who happen to know this information can access the protections of their nationality, or, alternatively, redefine the legal person by a process of lawful conversion, which is what we do. Most of us have suffered from the unlawful conversion of our lawful persons like Peter Olson into these foreign, international legal persons like Peter John Olson and must undertake an answering lawful conversion to reverse the process. Because we have many records and property held in these foreign, international names, we have to keep control of the legal person we've been unwittingly operating under. To rectify this and still keep control of our property interests requires us to convert the legal person by declaring its permanent home and domicile on the land of a sovereign state. This process effectively dry docks the legal person and makes it subject to the law of the land, bringing it under the protections and conventions of the constitutions and the international land laws, such as the Geneva Conventions. A judge seeing the name Peter John Olson assumes that he is dealing with a legal person in the international jurisdiction of the sea. After you lawfully convert this legal person by seizing upon it and declaring its domicile on the land jurisdiction, a whole new set of legal presumptions and laws apply. It will be your responsibility to inform the judges in your cases that your legal person, for example, Peter John Olson, has been lawfully converted and returned to the land jurisdiction. The paperwork that you record is evidence of the lawful conversion you have executed and the fact that Peter John Olson is now subject to the law of the land. You must do a similar correction with all the municipal persons that have been gifted to you for similar reasons. When you are addressed by any municipal or territorial district or state of state court, you must immediately challenge its jurisdiction and appeal the issue to the circuit court. I challenge this court's jurisdiction and appeal to the circuit court. The circuit court is the only court left that can bring a panel of three military officers and make a determination of your political status, consider the facts of your case, and grant you relief. 4. Okay, I have lawfully converted all these persons and returned them to the land jurisdiction. I returned and surrendered the municipal person birth certificate to competent international law enforcement officers and returned the trademark names to the land jurisdiction, too. I recorded the certificates for those along with the rest of the paperwork. I understand that I am a state national of the United States with a capital T, not a United States citizen and not a citizen of the United States. Now what? You are now clear to claim your actual state citizenship and assemble your State of the Union. Go to www.theamericanstatesassembly.net to get started. 5. How can we enforce this? The moment you arrive back on the land jurisdiction and assume your role as one of the people of this country, you are enabled to enforce the constitutional agreements and have a duty to do so. We enforce the constitutions by assembling our states, populating our public offices, filling our vacated courts, commissioning our continental marshals, electing our land jurisdiction sheriffs, and joining our state militia. Many people assume that only uniformed police officers have the power to make arrests and only state of state courts have any ability to prosecute crimes. They also think that militias are dangerous and inhabited by right-wing nutcases. None of this is true. In this country, every American who accepts the responsibility of state citizenship has the right to make citizen arrests. Even Americans who happen to be working as foreign law enforcement officers on a for-hire basis have the ability to enforce the public laws, including the provisions of the constitutions, C.Mac and Prinz v. USA, Inc. Moreover, every state citizen between the ages of 21 and 45, who is mentally and physically fit, is by definition a member of the state militia. We are not at war with anyone and we are not part of the commercial mercenary squabbles of our run-amuck employees, but we do owe a duty to the public peace and we also have a duty to ourselves and to our country to enforce the actual public law. In addition to a public declaration of peace by President Trump, we can lawfully and peacefully impose our control over our jurisdictions, which include the land and soil of this country. Bringing a permanent end to the bogus civil war and all the false legal presumptions and frauds and unauthorized offices associated with it is as easy and as difficult as issuing a credible order as an organized civilian government. This requires having active jural assemblies in at least a majority of the states. We are close to that goal now, and could have the job done tomorrow, if certain parties would wake up and face the necessity of doing the paperwork to return the legal persons and convert them into lawful persons. 6. Why can't we just use our plain names, the original lawful names, like Peter Olson, form our assemblies, and go forward? Because there is now no record of anyone called Peter Olson being born at the time and place where you were born. This is what I meant about having to maintain control of the foreign legal person and lawfully convert it. Your name has been unlawfully removed for the land and soil of your country, and illegally administered. A foreign improper legal name has been substituted for your lawful name. You have to convert the legal name and reconvey it back to the land and soil jurisdiction of the state where you were born and operate it as your lawful name in order to retain and control your assets and still be able to operate the land jurisdiction of your state. New records will have to be established. This is only a sufficient fix to protect everyone's material interests and bring our civilian populace back under the protections of land law. The ultimate resolution of this mess involves the Queen or her successor returning all the purloined copyrights to the American legal person names which have been operated for profit by the British Crown, and the Pope calling an end to the issuance of municipal persons in our names. Until then, we have to slog it out one by one by one, and we have to use the authorities that we definitely do have to correct the records and deal with the circumstance. They are our employees and they have no right to conduct any war on our land and soil, no right to presume anything about our identities or political status as babies, no excuse for what they have done. We have every right to fire them and hire new subcontractors to provide whatever services we want. Once we return to our proper status and accept the responsibility of self-governance, we have the power to direct both the territorial and municipal United States to stand down and put a permanent end to their squabbling and self-interested double-dealing, and especially their attempts to genocide Americans on paper and retain institutions of slavery. 7. If, as you say, the document we are familiar with as the Constitution of the United States of America is just a doppelganger of the real territorial constitution, very similar, but not the same, and its 14th Amendment is just a bylaw of a defunct Scottish commercial corporation, not an amendment to any constitution ratified by our states, what in the name of Jesus is going on? Fraud. Just plain old garden variety fraud. There is no excuse or valid basis for the enforcement of the 14th Amendment or, for that matter, any such amendment. Mr. Trump has made references to the purported 14th Amendment and, like most Americans, has taken it seriously. But like Black's Law Dictionary, it began as a spoof, a knowing fraud, that was taken seriously. That allowed the con artists to assume our identity, access our credit, and operate our government as if they were us, when in fact they were just con artists, an early version of identity thieves and credit card hackers. Until we wake up and inform Mr. Trump of the facts and he realizes that he is standing on sand, both lawfully and legally, the territorial government he represents will continue to enforce a known fraud as if it had validity and will continue to enforce de facto slavery long after all such provisions have been outlawed on a worldwide basis. If we are sick and tired of this preposterous circumstance, it's time to lift our ugly heads and roar something to the effect, the Articles of Incorporation of a defunct Scottish commercial corporation that ceased operations in 1907 have no authority, meaning, or enforceability on anyone today. Get your heads screwed on or go away. The greatest danger to this country is our own gullibility, general ignorance, and failure to take action. Those of us who are awake must make every effort to act as modern-day Paul Revere's and put as many sticks in the wagon wheels of these run-amuck corporations as possible. 8. What is being done to stop these criminals from doing us and other people harm? First and foremost, the information is getting out and into the hands of foreign governments, including the foreign governments responsible for this horse hooey. This has two immediate effects. One, friendly governments now have an understanding of what has gone on here and are inclined to intercede in our favor. Two, governments and corporations that were scheming against us and against our property interests on many levels are now exposed and their criminality is apparent. Thus, they are encouraged to cease and desist and are being obliged to slink back into the shadows. Second, once the legal persons are seized upon and converted and returned to the land jurisdiction, land law clamps down and people are again protected by the constitutional guarantees and Geneva Conventions and other provisions that the perpetrators have to honor or be further exposed as crime syndicates. Third, your Federation of Sovereign States, the United States of America, which is your official ship of state, is still seaworthy and competent to act in your favor while you attend to the task of assembling your states and getting on your feet. We have lost no time in rebutting false claims of abandonment and false claims that our currency is insufficient. We have also put numerous protections in place to stop the looting at an international level, including notices and liens and fixture attachments on all assets belonging to the states and people of this country. This has been a long process that has run in tandem and in multiple jurisdictions, and poses an effective rebuttal to globalist claims that we no longer exist and their attempts to seize our property. I know this is all a huge amount of unhappy information to take in, and I fully sympathize with the dismay and sense of being overwhelmed that many people feel. However, the actual states and people of this country have many friends and supporters. The United States of America is widely revered, our founding principles are strong and valid and second to none, our government structure has resisted all attempts to circumvent it, and we have cleared the pathway home. What remains is for each one of us who are free to do so, to correct the records and convey and convert the legal persons associated with us, and then assemble our actual states, which are physically defined and occupy the international land jurisdiction of this country. Go to www.theamericanstatesassembly.net website to get help with the paperwork involved and to get started on the whole reclamation process.